A very good morning and welcome to the 18th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have no apologies this morning. Our first item of business for today is a decision to take agenda items 6 and 9 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. Our next item is a consideration of a Scottish statutory instrument, the Disability Assistance for Older People, Consequential Amendment and Transitional Provision, Scotland Regulations 2024. This instrument is subject to the negative procedure, and the purpose of this instrument is to make consequential amendments and transitional provision as a result of the introduction of the pension age disability payment, which will soon replace attendance allowance in Scotland for people over state pension age. Do members have any comments on the instrument? Okay, I invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are members content to note the instrument?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Our next item is an evidence session with the Scottish Charity Regulator, Oscar. I welcome to the meeting Marika Dwarshouse, I hope I've pronounced that correctly, Board Chair, and Martin Tyson, Head of Regulation and Improvement. So thank you both for accepting our invitation. I now invite Marika to make a short opening statement. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chair. Well, good morning, Committee. My name is Marika Dwarshouse, and I'm the Chair of the Scottish Charity Regulator, and next to me is Martin Tyson, who's our Head of Regulation and Improvement. And we're very, very pleased to be here today and have been invited to talk about our work, and we very much welcome the interest of the Committee in our work. Now, before I go on to talk about the Charity Regulator and its work, I would actually like to give a very quick overview of the sector that we regulate. And I want to do that because we, as the regulator, are the authoritative source of data on the charity sector, because we collect, as part of our work, data on all charities in Scotland, because we have to keep a register of all charities in Scotland. And we also collect a huge range of data every year through our annual returns that charities have to submit to us. So we're therefore the only body really in Scotland that has a 360-degree view of the charity sector, from the very small volunteer-run organisations meeting in your local community centres to the multi-billion pounds institutions with international reputation, thousands of staff and many, many beneficiaries. So we're not a representative organisation for charities because we're the regulator. So we have a unique viewpoint based around our analysis of substantial data rather than opinion. Our data is up to date and available to all through our interactive sector overview report, through our register that can be searched in different ways and can be downloaded, but also through constituency maps. I don't know if members have ever sort of taken the opportunity to look at the charity profile in their constituency. And we are developing other interactive tools, and this can all be accessed from our website. And this data can and is good to put to good use to inform policy and other decision-making by government, parliament, local government and other stakeholders to make better informed decisions. So we are very keen that our data is used, and we would be more than happy to work with the committee or with any MSP if you have any specific queries about the makeup of the sector, whether nationally, regionally or locally. So what do we know then about the sector? Well, you'll probably be familiar with some of these figures. There's currently just over 25,000 charities registered in Scotland. But these charities are managed by a total of more than 180,000 charity trustees. But what's also important to realise is 69% of the charities in Scotland, that is more than 17,000 of those 25,000, employ no paid staff at all and are entirely run by volunteers. And partly in parallel with that, the majority of charities in Scotland are focused on the local area, with 41% operating a specific local point, a community or neighbourhood, and a further 25% operating within one local authority area only. and 53% of the 25,000 have an annual income of less than £25,000, and 31% an annual income of less than £5,000. And I'll throw a couple more figures at you. It's also interesting to know that while more than half of all the charities in Scotland make up for less than 0.5% of the sector's total annual income, on the other hand, 9% of all the charities registered on our register account for 96% of the gross annual income of the sector. So it is a hugely varied sector. And what does that mean for Oscar as a regulator? Well, that huge diversity that we regulate, that actually poses a number of challenges for us as a regulator, because we have to make sure that we have a system and a method of regulation that is proportionate, fair and consistent across that huge diversity of organisations. To also give you a picture, some of those, if you wonder what these really large charities are, well, we're talking about, for example, universities, further education colleges, the big names that you see, but also housing associations. And of course, that gets us into the territory of organisations that have more than one regulator. We also regulate organisations that are regulated by others. Housing associations are some of those, but also some care providers will be regulated by others. So the data that I just talked about and other sector information that we collect really through our daily interactions with charities, but also from the public and from our engagement with stakeholders, inform our regulatory priorities. And these help us to focus, in particular, our proactive long-term work towards what we see as the key risks in the sector, and also to risk assess and triage incoming intelligence so that we prioritise the cases that come in around those risks. We are a small organisation, and prioritisation of the incoming casework is a particularly important task for us. So our data guides us towards becoming a more informed, a more preventive and risk-based regulator. So that's a little bit about the sector that we regulate and how we use data and how others also use our data. A little bit then about Oscar itself. We are a non-ministerial office. We are accountable directly to Parliament, not to ministers. We have a non-executive board with 7 members, and that includes myself. At the end of 23-24, we had a headcount of 43, 8 of which are part-time members, so it's a small organisation. We now have a headcount of 45, as we've taken on, and we'll come on to that later, some temporary staff to assist with the work to prepare for the implementation of the 2023 Act, and no doubt we'll come on to that. Our funding comes from Scottish Government through the third sector unit, and our budget this year is £3.6 million, and that is an uplift from last year and reflects very much the constructive discussions we've had with Scottish Government colleagues to take account of the work that we need to do for the digital changes and the engagement costs of implementing the 2023 Act. It's a very challenging budget, particularly in view of the public pay settlement, public sector pay settlements during this period, and again the additional work in preparing for the implementation of the Act. And we're therefore very focused on the need to continue to achieve clear efficiencies, as we have done in previous years, and I'll come on to that in a minute. One thing I want to say is that when the board, together with the staff, developed our corporate strategy for 23-26, the board were very keen that we should develop a means of measuring how the work of the regulator is making a difference. And we have concentrated on developing some clear measures of success in relation to our strategic priorities so that we can show the impact of the sector, the impact of our work on the sector and for the public. And we're still looking to improve these indicators, that we will stick to the ones we've got for the period of this corporate strategy period, as it is not easy to articulate meaningful and feasible measures of success for regulation. But it is what our corporate plan is driving at. I'd also like to take a few minutes, if I can, to tell you about the transformation journey that the organisation has been on in the past few years, largely before I arrived as chair. I've been the chair now for 18 months. And of which we are now really starting to reap the benefits. As you probably have seen in the briefing that was prepared for you, in the period 2021 to 24, Oscar saw its budget in cash terms reduced by 8% from 3.6 to 3.2 3 million, whilst costs, including staff costs, continue to increase. And that funding reduction acted as a catalyst to accelerate the reform programme that we began in 2020 with our organisational redesign. And over the past 3 years, we have undertaken changes that are planned over a five-year period, and we are now delivering better within the reduced resource envelope. And that has been a result of a fundamental restructure of the organisation in 2020, with a refresh of all the staff roles, bringing high levels of flexibility and creating new remits. And I believe that we can now truly say that we are an agile organisation. We're able to quickly respond to changes in workloads and priorities. We focused on the smart use of our funding to front-load on digital spend, to enable increased automation of routine tasks, increasing our efficiency, and also, very importantly, improving our service to charities. By redesigning our processes and procedures, we've enabled faster, better targeted handling of incoming cases, and that is now really starting to show in what is coming through in our performance measures. We've moved, importantly also, to online platforms for most engagement activity with charities and other stakeholders through the smart use of in-house technology. And we're maximising the benefits from IT contracts, and we've built capacity in-house to improve and innovate IT systems. And that's important because then on a continuing basis we can keep costs down and be as responsive as possible. So I believe this change programme shows how OSCAR is embracing the principles of public service reform agenda and is embedding them in all our activities and our decision-making processes. And if I may, at this point, I'd really like to take the opportunity to pay tribute to Maureen Mallon, who has been OSCAR's chief executive for the past 6 years and who will be retiring at the end of this month. So Maureen has been instrumental, really, in bringing about the transformation of the organisation, and we are very grateful for her positive legacy. Returning then to public service reform, it's also worth noting that we share some corporate services with other public bodies. For example, our finance services are delivered by the Care Inspectorate, who are our neighbours in Dundee, and we are proactive members of the Dundee Accommodation Hub, and very keen to explore further collaboration working opportunities with other organisations, publicly funded organisations that are now co-located on the riverside in Dundee. So I am coming to a close. Looking then to the year and possibly further ahead, we have three key issues to focus on. Firstly, and this will be no doubt at the forefront of the committee's mind as well, the implementation of the 2023 Charities Regulation and Administration Act. And this includes the introduction of a database of charity trustees and publishing charity accounts. Now, this is, of course, not an end in itself, but a way of achieving key outcomes for the sector and the public by increasing transparency for everyone and letting us, as the regulator, move further towards becoming a risk-based and data-driven regulator. Secondly, and this may come somewhat as a surprise perhaps, but it is important to realise that we are finding that conflict and poor relationships within charities and between charities and communities is an increasing area of concern and activity for OSCAR, and it is one of our greatest areas of regulatory priority. Our experience indicates that this increase reflects the greater challenges faced by charities over the past few years, the lack of capacity for trustees to deal with the issues before they blow up, but also the lack of awareness of where trustees can get support. And we will be addressing this issue in a number of ways over the coming years, such as working with umbrella bodies and funders to help guide charities' trustees through the issues, by ourselves developing new guidance materials and making changes to have better risk assessments of incoming casework. And thirdly, and in conclusion, we will continue to work positively with the Scottish Government and other public bodies on the public service reform agenda, and we will be very much seeking further productivity gains through the smart use of technology, through collaboration, always making sure we regulate in a way that adds values to charities and builds public confidence in the sector. So I hope this introduction has given you a useful flavour of our current position and our priorities, and I very much look forward to our further discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Marika. That was very, very helpful. And I think I speak on behalf of all the committee and say good luck to Maureen in her retirement. So thank you. Before we move on to the questions, a few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. If you please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. We have approximately about an hour, and can I ask everyone to keep questions and answers as concise as possible. So we'll now move to questions, and the first theme is theme one on strategy and priorities. So OSCAR has five priorities in its 2023 to 26 corporate strategy, and five different priorities in its regulatory priorities for 24 to 26, and six of those focuses, you know, are listed online in how we regulate section of the website. Can you possibly explain the purpose of the various different lists of priorities and how they actually interact with one another?
Yes, I can. If I can start with the how we regulate part of what you're referring to, that really is essentially listing the underlying focus that OSCAR has in law. So if I remember correctly, it says we need to keep a register of charities, we need to monitor charities' compliance. Martin, keep me right here. Mm-hmm. So there's six things, and they are pretty much directly taken from the legislation. So that really is how we carry out the things we do to carry out our work, if you like, of the things we are empowered to do, really, to carry out our regulatory function. The corporate strategy sets out the broad strategic priorities for the whole organisation over the period to 26, taking in both our regulatory casework, our forward-looking, preventative, outward-looking work, and our functions and duties as a public body. So it ranges from ensuring that the public have the information that they need about charities to looking after the well-being of our staff. So it incorporates that range of the internal and the external things that we want to prioritise. But within that, in particular within our regulatory work, the regulatory priorities set out the issues within the sector that we are going to concentrate on and that will shape our assessment of casework risk. So that those are really the aspects of our regulatory work that we think over this period are going to be most important for us to keep an eye on. I hope that explains.
Yeah, no, that's been really helpful. Thank you. I'm now going to move and invite Bob Doris now. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I'm not sure if I have to declare, but just for transparency, I'm a trustee of a small charity called Spirit of Springburn. No financial gain in relation to that. I think it's a voluntary registration, my register of interest, so I should declare it at this point. So there's clearly going to be a significant amount of work needed to implement the 2023 Charities Act. And I suppose that means there's no business as usual, and things have to change, and there is a impact on resource. Could one of you perhaps give an example of how you've had to change that business as usual to do something different to allow you to implement the 2023 Act? That would be very helpful, I think.
Okay. Will I kick off on that, or do you want to? Well, I'll leave Martin because he deals with this on a day-to-day basis. So.
Yeah, I think one example would be where we've switched resources from within the casework teams to focus on one of the early commencements, which was our power to remove charities that which weren't supplying annual accounts and returns as they're required to do, and it kind of ceased to engage with the regulator. So we switched people and resources last year to focus on the preparatory work for that, but also to sort of maximise our engagement and our communications with some of the charities affected. So it was a switch of focus. There were some of the bits of routine casework that we streamlined and that we took the focus off a little bit to allow us to do that. So a lot of those early commencements were done from within the existing resources.
Okay, so that's a really helpful specific example of the impact. I suppose my follow-up question would be, what has the impact been on the casework for the casework teams that are left to deal with, I would imagine, the same amount of inquiries, or perhaps good amount of inquiries with less staff to do that? And just before you answer that, because I will be time sensitive today, if there's other examples of where there's been impact. Could you put that on the record as well? And then I can move on to my next question at that point.
Yeah. So in terms of the casework, actually we've done pretty well, and the stats over the year have improved, and I think that's partly because of some of the work that Marika talked about in earlier years, where we've streamlined processes and I think also become much better at risk assessment, at triaging the incoming work to identify high-risk stuff that needs a lot of work, but also give a smooth passage through to say, applications and things that are very straightforward, and where we just need to get out of the way of charities and let them do the thing they want to do. In terms of other examples where we've reprioritised, I think one example would be around work we were wanting to concentrate on around our agreements and memoranda of understanding with other regulators and other public bodies, where we had to switch focus a little bit away from that, and we had to retime that, and we'll be taking that through in the coming year.
Okay, that's very helpful. I'm sure the committee would welcome and kept updated if there is any detrimental impact, but clearly it's an organisation that's changing to adapt to the additional pressures and financial realities. So if we look at the five regulatory priorities that's been set by Oscar for 24 through to 2026, how are these determined? I've looked at them, they look pretty clear, dare I say obvious in some respects, but how are they determined? What progress has been made in relation to the priorities that you've set since their introduction?
If I can kick off, do you mind? Actually, it links back to data. So the priorities are informed by the information we get in. So we look at the types of cases that come in, also the other information that comes into the organisation as to what the key issues are from a range of sources of information. And it's probably worth stressing that it's the board that agreed these regulated priorities, and we've had quite a bit of discussion about that to determine whether these were the right ones to focus on. It's also worth mentioning that these will be regularly reviewed. So we've initially set these for a year. We've now had some discussions that, well, actually a year's not long enough to know what the impact has been. Maybe we should leave that 18 months for review so that we get to see the impact of our work. But that's really sort of the governance process, is the board has agreed the regulator priorities. But in terms of how exactly that was done and the progress you've made, I'll hand note to Martin.
Yeah, so as Marika says, a lot of that was to do with our data. For instance, it was very clear that the number of charities that were defaulting on their obligation to provide accounts and not engaging with us had crept up through the COVID period, when I think a lot of charities ceased operations or went into mothballs. So the numbers there were very clear, and it was very clear that was a priority to maintain confidence in regulation. Other things that influenced that were intelligence coming through from concerns from the public or from other regulators or indeed from MSPs sometimes, and that's where the priority about conflict in charities came from, just a sense that we were getting some increasingly complex and difficult situations within charities. The priority on reserves, actually, that came through from the sector, a sort of very good piece of research that was done within the Scottish charity sector, I think driven by some of the big charitable funders, about how charities used their reserves and how they could use them better. And it was clear that the sector thought that was a priority, and we agreed.
Can I just ask one final question then? And I suppose it's... Yeah. I don't think I've really had much time at all, convener, but of course I will. Now, do senior officers within Oscar analyse the data and make recommendations to the chair and board in relation to the priorities set, or do they give the chair and board options? Marika, I suppose what I'm trying to gather is how dynamic and vibrant the board is at holding senior management to account in the priorities that they set.
In this particular case, it was a matter of the senior staff analysing the information and saying, on the basis of what we have found, we believe these to be the priorities. We didn't sort of get a list of options, a menu to choose from, if you like. That's not to say that on other occasions that isn't how it works, but in this case, because it was a data-driven proposal for regulator priorities, the first scenario that you were sketching is the one that applied.
Okay, I'll, because of time constraints, I was maybe going to leave that hanging. I would,
Just to come in, if I recall correctly, we had a couple of goes at it. Because the board sort of, came back and asked challenged on a number of things.
Yeah, but not on the basis of a menu of options, if you like. The priorities were put forward and we questioned them. It wasn't sort of just something that comes to the board and we rubber stamp it. I believe it was over two, possibly even three meetings before we were all convinced and agreed that this was the way to go.
And the reason I asked was because you are one of the regulators of housing associations. When I meet housing association chairs and board members, I always ask them whether they challenge senior management within the housing associations in a positive way. That's a constructive aspect, but thank you for putting that on the record.
Thank you. Thanks, Bob. Moving on now to theme two, which is funding and financial performance. I'm going to invite Marie McNair in. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. The questions I was going to ask have effectively been covered in your opening statement, so I'll just hand back to yourself and move on. Cheers.
Okay. Okay, thank you. We move on to the theme three, which is staffing. I'm going to invite Katie Clarke in. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Scottish governments are ultimately responsible for charity law and third sector policy. And I understand that OSCAR work closely with the Scottish Government's charity law team to ensure effective regulation. How well does that work in practice? How frequently do you engage with the Scottish Government? And do you think that the level of collaboration is effective? If I go to Marika to start with.
Yes. So I'll take that at its sort of highest level, if you like. Mm-hmm. You're aware, of course, as I said, we're a non-ministerial organisation, so we're accountable to Parliament rather than the Minister and very much independent of Ministers. And our relationship with the Scottish Government is governed by a framework agreement that we've set with them that sets out the parameters of our relationship, including where the different touch points are with the Scottish Government, in particular the third sector units, because that's the part of the Scottish Government where we are sitting, if you like, who we liaise with and what the focus of that liaison particularly is. Myself, for example, I would be meeting with the director and once or sometimes twice a year with the minister to update, but particularly with the director at a regular but not hugely frequent intervals, signalling really that the relationship is good. But then underneath that, there's a huge number of touch points and a lot of activity, which is really about the sort of things you're talking about, development of charity law. But not only are those links with the charity law team and the third sector, but also other parts of the Scottish Government. So Martin will say a little bit more about that.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yes, I mean, at the operational level, the contacts are very frequent. We work pretty closely with colleagues in the third sector area around the 23 Act, and work right through that, the passage of that. We're talking with them now about secondary legislation that's necessary to bring that in, and we talk a lot around some of the incidental things around that. We also talk quite often to other parts of Scottish Government. There is, one of the things we need to do is to spot other legislation in other areas that will impact on charities, will impinge on us as a regulator. So we will quite frequently have contacts with other parts of Scottish Government, whether that's responding to formal consultations or whether it's discussions about upcoming policy or legislation. So it's frequent, and I mean, to a great extent, some of that's relatively informal as opposed to the more formal contacts that Marika's talking about.
Okay, thank you. And I know that Marika referred to a fundamental restructuring that's taken place and that OSCAR launched a people strategy in July 2022, detailing plans to support staff to thrive and develop new skills, and I'm obviously quoting. So what specific actions does this involve, and how is that progressing? Could you, you've said a little bit about that in your opening statement, but yeah. could you perhaps expand mm-hmm. in yeah. terms of what that means from your perspective mm-hmm. and any concerns that have been raised?
Mm-hmm. Well, it's interesting that you make the link to the restructuring of the organisation. So it was in that context, really, that we recruited an HR learning and development coordinator 3 years ago to provide substantial in-house support and expertise to deliver our people strategy, because we recognised that with the big change that was going on in the organisation, and to maintain the changes that were being made and to support people in that, HR learning and development coordinator would be hugely beneficial. And it's turned out to be that way. We launched the people strategy in July 22, as you mentioned. Just to mention a few things that we have done in that. The board actually just received an update report on this to our last board meeting, where we were very pleased to see that very good progress has been made on all the key aspects of the people strategy. And a couple of things to mention in that. We've embedded hybrid working. Now, that might seem a sort of statement almost of the, well, we would expect that, but that is not necessarily an easy thing to do. And I believe that in Oscar it's been very effective. We've got a very good mix of attendance in the office and people working remotely, and we've seen no loss of productivity as a result of that at all, quite the opposite, in fact. So we're very pleased with that, and it's still able to maintain very good collaborative working between people throughout the change to hybrid working. We've developed internal guidance and training materials alongside also having developed a tailored corporate training plan, which has training outlined for all different groups of staff, mandatory training as well as other training, including board members. We've supported and trained line managers to be confident in their role, and we continue to regularly review the priorities that people work to ensure that our people resource is always focused on addressing the priority work. So, and we also have a keen focus on well-being, and we want to, and we've worked to understand what well-being in the workplace and outside work means for people and how we can best support this. And we've introduced the Staff Hub, which is an intranet site to aid internal communication. And what's been very, very pleasing for everybody, the staff, the managers, the HR coordinator and the board to see, is that as a result of this work, we've seen an increase from 56% to 65% in our engagement score in the civil service people survey. And that is very important, because during the years where there was such a lot of change in the organisation, it's always difficult in an organisation to go through change. That had taken a dip, and it's very much on an improving journey now, so I think it's working.
Yeah, and have there been any concerns raised? I mean, have staff raised concerns, or have some of these changes been in response to problems that existed within the organisation that were recognised?
That's a slightly difficult question for me to answer, because I can honestly say that in the 18 months that I've been there, mm-hmm. I would say the answer to that is no. Okay. Whether or not there have been issues raised in the period where the change was, if you like, at its most active, I can't really say. I don't know whether, Martin, you want to say anything about that.
Yeah, I think, you know, just to be quite open about that, it was a reasonably difficult process. I think we were, you know, dealing with a number of sort of long-standing ways of working, and I suppose, you know, ways of being in the organisation. So, you know, some of that was quite difficult. There's some quite difficult, you know, conversations and transition to go through. But we are, I think, starting to see the benefit now.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, sorry, thank you very much. Now moving on to theme four, which is performance for 23-24. I'm going to invite Paula Kane in. Thanks.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to our panel. A number of these issues, I suppose, were touched on as well in opening comments, but I think we're particularly interested in a couple of areas in terms of performance. In the performance report for 23-24, we had noted, you know, some data not being available in terms of certain KPIs. KPIs, most notably website visitors and helpfulness training. And I know we've, as I say, started to touch on some of the investments that are being made. But I wonder if you can say what progress OSCR would hope to make in respect of that more widely.
Yeah, so I mean, for instance, in respect of those two KPIs around the website's stats, we have started to collect those now. There was a couple of software things that we needed to do to make that possible. So we started to gather data on those from late 23, and the early indications are that we're on track to meet our objectives with that, but we haven't got the whole year's data on those. I mean, there was overall, I think we did pretty well with the KPIs. There was another couple where we're not there yet. I think, for instance, around inquiries, we have a target to complete 60% of our inquiries into possible wrongdoing in charities within 6 months, and we're not there with that yet. Now, that's interesting. Partly that reflects we have some really complex cases. We have cases where there is, court procedures going on, where there are other regulators or the police involved, and we have to interact with those kind of timescales. But there's partly bits where we could just do with being faster, and we need to look at working with greater pace. But I think also taking that risk-based approach right through looking very rigorously at the existing cases we have when they're sort of coming up to that six-month timescale, working out what we do with them, whether the risks are still there, do we still need to be involved in that? So that's work we'll be focusing on in the coming year.
Convener, it was remiss of me at the start of this contribution not to declare my interest as an OSCR registered charity trustee until 2023, just for the record. I wonder, just in terms of that point about, I think, website and people feeling, helpfulness, I think, in terms of the ratings, is that about searching the register or trying to access information? Do we have that level of detail, essentially?
Yes. So we ask about the whether people have got what they need from the register, but also about the helpfulness of the guidance that's on the website.
Okay. Thank you. In terms of where measures are not currently being met, for example, those cases of concern not being achieved. Is there a resourcing issue around some of that? Do you feel that there's a further resource required for OSCR in order to drive some of that forward, or is it more about the existing resource?
No, I think we feel we just about have the resources that we need in that area. I think we have a sort of reasonably settled team as well, and I think that helps. Some of the other measures that relate to casework reflect that as well, where we're doing a lot of other casework much more quickly than we did. I think it is about looking at those specific issues around inquiries.
Okay. I noticed that in the report as well there was a goal to review and refresh memorandums of understanding and partnership agreements, but that wasn't met due to reprioritisation. So I wonder if you can maybe just explain to committee what was reprioritised over it, and exactly what were some of the examples of those things that were not met?
Yeah, so we kind of mentioned earlier when we were talking about the implementation of the 2023 Act, this was one example where I think A, we had a member of staff move on, and B, we needed to reprioritise to meet some of what we needed to do under the 2023 Act. I think also this is one of these areas where it takes two to tango. We had priorities and things that we wanted to do with the memorandum of understanding, but the partner organisations also had priorities, so it was probably a slightly longer and more complex process than we maybe thought.
Okay,
thank you very much. Now, sticking with that theme, I'm going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
Thank you, convener, and also I'm a trustee of one charity currently. If I could start actually with your annual report, it mentions the SORP, which I've now forgotten exactly what that stands for, a statement of recommended practice, and it says you're involved in that. So I just wonder if you could expand on that and what changes you think there might be, because I mean it does seem to me that charity accounts are pretty complex and lengthy at the moment. I'm involved in a church. Virtually nobody in the church even reads all the accounts, let alone, you know, has a good grasp of them. Yeah.
So the statement of recommended practice, like a lot of sectors, charities has a statement of recommended practice that says how the sector should do its accounts to recognise the particular characteristics it has. The charity SOAP applies to larger charities and to charitable companies. So, you know, it may be that the you know, the charity that you're talking about, if it's a smaller charity, it will be able to do more simplified accounts. This is largely for the big ones where there is a degree of complexity in the reporting. In Scotland, the statement of recommended practice is actually, you know, it's embodied in the secondary legislation about charity accounts. We are part of the SOAP making body, along with the Charity Commission in Wales and the Charity Commission for Northern Ireland. So we work with them to write the charity SOAP. We're engaged at the moment in updating the SOAP, and that was very much influenced by demands in the sector for a way of doing more complex charity accounts that met the needs of the people who are making, you know, who are writing the accounts, the charities themselves, you know, to simplify and make it clearer, but also, and very importantly, the needs of the people who use the accounts, whether that's the public, whether it's funders, government or whoever it is that interact with accounts. So the work that's that's going on at the moment, it's been very much influenced by what users of accounts on both sides want, and you know, the work that's going on, and it's been reasonably long term, is to try and do that within the parameters that are set down by the Financial Reporting Council.
Okay, well, I'm sure we'll hear more about that in due course, but fair enough. Now, in your you've also talked about Oscar Online, and I was having a quick look at your website. I see there's 200,839 charities in Glasgow, of which 50 have an income of over £10 million. So it's quite easy to find some of that kind of information. Do you want to tell us a little bit more about Oscar Online and why that was produced and what difference you feel it's made?
Yeah, I mean, we had an interactive system before that for charities to provide information to us and to submit their accounts and their annual returns. And what we did was to we've done it, you know, really on a couple of occasions in the last couple of years, is to update that to make it more friendly for the people who are supplying information to us. So one thing we did was to make sure it's compatible with mobile phones and tablet browsers. This is because, you know, a lot of people, especially in smaller charities, they're not sitting down with a whole lot of computer kit. They're, you know, doing what they need to do for us on their phones, and it, you know, helps them to do that. We did things like making the process for resetting passwords a lot simpler. We increased the number of registered contacts that a charity could have to supply information to us, and again, that was to make life easier for charities. We've also updated the range of emails that we send automatically to charity trustees at various stages to give them better information about what they need to do and a bit more guidance. Just at the end of last year, we put in some more updates, and that was really to enhance the value of the annual return to charity trustees. It makes it a lot more interactive, a lot more responsive to the answers that the charity is giving, so that they get tailored guidance, tailored emails based on the response they're given. For instance, if there are issues, they have too few charity trustees, you know, that they're not quorate, we go back and say, you're not quorate, here's what you need to do about it. Other governance issues and you know, other issues that come out of the information that they're given, and making it a lot more tailored. And the response that we're getting so far on that, we're not through the full cycle yet, but the response we're getting so far on that is very positive.
Okay, I mean, I think that kind of ties in. You mentioned earlier how you try and, you know, adapt to whether it's a big charity you're dealing with or a small charity. I mean, is the word charity just covering too big an area?
That's an interesting question, and you know, as Marika said, it is a hugely diverse sector. You are applying the same set of principles to bodies that are very different, and you know that's the task in front of us. That's what the law says we have to do. I mean, you know, there is a bit of a consultation going on at the moment about aspects of charity law, so we'll be very interested to see what comes out of that.
Okay, thank you. And going back to the performance report, you've obviously met, it appears, quite a lot of your targets. How would you set the targets then for the following year? Do you increase them all, and who approves that? Or do you, I mean, some organisations, frankly, make their targets very easy, so then it looks like they're doing really well.
Yeah. Well, they are approved by the board. I think the targets that we set in our initial round of the corporate strategy, I thought they were stretch targets, most of them, and we have been very pleasantly surprised by the ability of the organisation to focus its efforts on meeting those. If I'm not mistaken, we are actually changing some of them. Am I thinking that right?
Yes, I think we've adjusted some of them to be clearer. Yeah. And also to reflect the fact that some of the original ones were quite stretching. Yeah.
So we are sort of looking at the information that comes back and how well we are able to meet them. And in some cases, we have actually found that the way we've articulated a particular target wasn't particularly helpful. In fact, we were starting to collect the data that didn't actually address the target that we were seeking. But also in some cases, we're finding that we are able to meet the target. And then, of course, it's a matter of considering whether or not we should then stretch the target further, or whether we are content with that. Because, of course, as soon as you stretch the target further, you do what you measure. I mean, this is what you often hear, and there is a degree of truth in that. But if you stretch a target further, when actually you might be content with the level of performance you have in relation to one, you might want to question yourself whether that is the right thing to do, or whether that actually then allows you focusing further on one of the targets that you're perhaps not yet meeting. We could say, well, we want to, you know, deal with all status cases within a month. But if we do that, then much of our resource goes there, whereas actually we're not meeting some of our targets in relation to dealing with inquiry cases. So you wouldn't necessarily want to then divert cases to an even more stretched target in one area, if actually it might mean that you want to use that resource elsewhere. So it's a balance of things.
OK, thanks, Convener. If you've got time at the end, I might come back.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you very much, John. And now moving on to theme five, which is the Charities Regulation and Administration Scotland Act 2023, and I'm going to invite Jeremy Balfour in. Thank you.
Excuse me. Good morning, panel. Thank you for coming. Can I also declare that I have been an amateur trustee of a number of charities? I had the pleasure of helping take the bill through this committee when it came, and obviously we now have the 2023 Act. 1st October 2024, and then summer next year. Some of the powers to direct charities to take specific actions, the power to appoint interim trustees, the requirement to create a publicly searchable record of disqualified trustees all come into force, as I'm sure you're all aware. I'm just wondering, what are you doing to prepare for these powers and requirements, and are you confident that you will be ready to meet these new responsibilities?
Yes, I think we are. I mean, just to sort of, you know, if you like, I can sort of, you know, talk in more, you know, and write to the committee to give me more detail. But broadly speaking, we had sort of two phases of commencement. We had a bunch of things that commenced on 1st of April 2024. Big thing there was the power to appoint interim trustees, and we've done a lot of work with the sector on that to identify sectors where that might be a useful power, but also where there would be people within those sort of subsectors who might be able to either act as interim trustees or help to train or advise interim trustees. And we got a very positive reception there. So that's a measure that's in force now, and it's one that we are regularly considering as part of our inquiry work. Another big thing there, I've already talked about it, is the power to remove defaulting and non-engaging charities. We, I think at the last count, have notified something like 308 charities that we're going to do that. So the momentum is quite quick on that now, and that involved right now to a lot of charities involved to give them due warning, and in some cases we were very successful in re-engaging with them, and we're now working with them to keep them up to date. So that's the stuff we've already done. Looking forward, obviously the big things are the database, the schedule of trustee details, the publication of trustee names on the register, and the publication of all charity accounts. We are well into the technical preparation for that. We've identified very detailed technical requirements, and we're evaluating the options to go forward and deliver those. The other thing we're doing is starting to, now that we have those sort of, that very detailed sense of how we'll do this, to engage with the sector on that, and we'll be making lots of phone calls and having lots of meetings with some of the specific areas of the sector that actually spoke to the committee or wrote to the committee last year, among others that we've identified. And clearly another area that we will be working on running up to summer 2025, which is the target date for the big set of commencements, will be the extension to automatic disqualification of charity trustees, and the extension of that automatic disqualification to senior charity staff. And there's extensive communication and engagement to be done there as well, and we're moving into that. As we've said, we have some additional funding from Scottish Government. We've used that to appoint a couple of engagement managers who come from the sector, have the contacts and the networks and the experience of the sector to help us get out and have those conversations, and they're getting into their work now. We also have a very experienced project manager who we've brought in to make sure that this will go through in the timescale and in the sort of budget that we're looking at.
Thank you for that. I mean, it would be helpful perhaps just to get a bit more detail than with specifics in writing after this meeting would be helpful. But thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Jeremy. I'm now going to invite Ros McCallan. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and welcome. I think actually your very comprehensive answer to Mr. Balfour has pretty much answered the kind of questions that I've got here. I'm just going to sort of narrow in a little bit, if I may, because I noticed in the opening remarks you highlighted the conflict that's not only within charities, but equally within charities and the communities that they serve. And the Charities Act, the 23 Charities Act, has a specific requirement on a communication and increasing that communication with charities. So can you give us a little bit more detail, because I know you've alluded to it in the answer you've just given my colleague, Mr. Balfour, but just a little bit more detail on how that communication is going to happen.
Yeah, I mean, to an extent, it's already happening. In that first phase of commencement, we did some very targeted engagement with particular subsectors who had expressed an interest around interim trustees, and that was very useful. Going forward, I mean, it is going to be a multi-stranded approach because, as we've talked about before, we have a very diverse sector, and different bits of the sector will be differently impacted by what's happening. For some parts of the sector, what's happening in terms of publishing accounts and publishing trustee names, well, that's kind of business as usual for them anyway, because they may have to do it for other regulators because they're a company and they do it in Companies House, so it's not a biggie for them. Other parts of the sector, that will be new, and it might be problematic, and some of the folks that responded to the committee's call for evidence were very clear about that. So we will be talking to them, about what's the impact on your particular sector, whether it's religious charities, whether it is the likes of Rape Crisis or Women's Aid. What's the impact of publishing trustee names, and how likely are they to take advantage of the exemptions that the Act allows us to make. Similarly, there was a lot of anxiety about the impact of automatic disqualification of senior staff on very specific bits of the charity sector. Yeah. Now, our take on that, looking at the overall numbers involved, is that it won't, you know, the overall numbers will be small, but we absolutely need to get into that. So we will be doing very specific engagement with some of those groups. We also need to do very targeted communication that takes into account that most charities are very small. They don't have policy officers sitting there looking at everything that comes through the door. They're people who are meeting up once a week to sort of do the business of the charity, and it's not their day job. So we need to make sure that they know what they need to do, when they need to do it, and we're not overloading them. It's the right stuff at the right time.
And you're comfortable so far with the way the communication process is set up, that's actually now opening, it's wide, it's happening, and that's happening on the ground?
It is now happening, yeah.
Yeah, thank you. Again, you've already pretty much answered this, but I'm just going to give you the opportunity to maybe give a little bit more detail. There's the new powers setting out in the Charities Act. The expectations of action to be taken, are there? What additional information can you give us? Because I say you've already alluded to this in the response to Mr. Balfour, but how are you preparing to take these actions forward? Is there any more information you want to give us on that?
Yeah, I mean, as I say, we have that sort of very structured view of communication. It's about the channels that we use, and we have a number of existing channels. Obviously, because we're the regulator, we have a sort of regular channel of communication with all charities as part of that annual cycle of the annual return, and that will be a key one. But there will also be much more focused things that we do where we think there are particular issues to be addressed. We have a newsletter which I think has a circulation both among charities and among people advised in charities that I think is around 9,000. That will be a key channel for us as well. But I think the other thing we need to work with, you know, there are some very well experienced and capable bodies within the sector who have a role in this as well, and I think we'll be keen to advise either their sector or their area.
No, that's very helpful, and thank you very much indeed. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much, Ros. I believe John Mason would like to come in, and then Jeremy. Thank you.
Okay, well, if I've got a little bit of time. On a slightly different subject, I noted in the whole question about which charities register in Scotland and which are also in England or that space. I mean, I saw it said that charities must have a significant connection to Scotland. Mm. And some of the big charities, I mean, I just looked at, checked some just now, Oxfam and things, they're registered with both, I think. But I do sometimes get appeal letters in and things from charities which are purely registered in England, but they're obviously seeking donations in Scotland. Should I be concerned that they're not registered with OSCAR?
Not necessarily. So there are... It sort of works in two slightly opposite and equal ways. There is and has been since 2005, a duty on charities that have a significant footprint in Scotland, and that means really, if you like, boots on the ground in Scotland to register here. So the likes of Oxfam, they have offices in Glasgow, they do lots of stuff here on a regular basis, they're required to register here. Where a charity, for instance, is... it's a grant-giving body, it's based in London, but people from Scotland can write to them and say, give us a grant. They don't need to register here. They're not carrying out activities on the ground here, but they are funding charities in Scotland. And I think that was a deliberate choice by the Parliament then. They didn't want to cut off Scottish charities from being able to access UK sources of charitable funding.
And is that something you pursue, that if you thought a charity was active here but wasn't registered?
Yes, and we do that.
Yes.
Yeah. So you know, if we come across something, you know, in the course of our inquiries, or if someone writes to us and says, I think these people should be registered, then quite often the example will be, oh, they've done a clothing collection, you know, they've had a bag through the door, or they've had an appeal letter. We will look at that. We'll look at their activities, you know, what we can find out publicly. We will write to them, find out what it is they do, and we'll make a judgment as to whether they're required to register.
Okay, thanks, Convener. That's me.
Okay, thank you. And Jeremy, I believe you'd like to come in. Thanks.
Thank you. I wonder if I just take back to the previous question by my colleague, Ross McCaw. In regard to a very small charity, so I was a trustee. I chaired a charity that had 3 trustees. We met literally around my kitchen table. I think it did quite good stuff, what we were doing, but, you know, we were all doing other things. How do you communicate with that really small charity who are doing a good thing very locally, but really don't have energy, time, resources to respond to you, compared to someone like the National Trust, which is a massive charitable organisation?
Yeah, and that is the most challenging part. And I think not just communicating one way with them, it's also very important that we hear that you know, those charities, you know, a lot of the time the views of those charities are quite seldom heard. And that can be because they're very small charities, or can, you know, because in some cases they're representing communities that are excluded in other ways. So we're putting a lot of thought in the moment into how we both have the one-way communication saying, you need to do this now, and here's some guidance and some help as to how to do it, but also to make sure that those kind of charities are able to influence what we're doing. You know, if we're building an interface to let them give us their trustee details, we need to know that it works for the people who are just sitting there around the kitchen table doing stuff on their phone, as well as the big charity that has an office and staff able to do it. So a lot of that will be working through intermediary bodies like umbrella bodies, the likes of SCVO, the third sector interfaces in local areas, some of the specific bodies, for instance, for religious charities or ethnic minority charities, and also targeting some of the kind of bodies that have signalled, you know, look, this might be a problem for us during the consultation and the passage of the bill.
Okay. I think it might be interesting to come back in a year's time to see how exactly all working, but that would be for the committee to look at. Thank you.
Can I quickly ask a question, and then we'll sort of kind of wrap it up? But and I met recently with one of our sort of local interface groups, VASLAN, within South Lanarkshire, and they're calling out for assistance from, you know, a lot in terms of the third sector organisations. And one of the things they talked about was shared services such as HR for smaller, you know, charities, as well as shared services in terms of shared procurement. Is that something Oscar would be able to help and give guidance on to try and assist the ones that are really struggling?
I think so. I don't think so is the answer, but I'll let Martin.
It's not, you know, that's not, you know, part of our remit, but, you know, that kind of assistance is what some, at least, of the third sector interfaces do and provide really good services. A lot of them do those, particularly HR and payroll and things like that. And, you know, that, I think, to an extent, is what they're funded for by Scottish Government and others. Where I think we can help is by clarifying what, you know, the limitations, if any, are on that in terms of trustee duties and independence and accounting for those kind of things, and, you know, simplifying and facilitating that where we can. It's slightly different, but what we have done along with, you know, and this is the same as a lot of the other charity regulators, is to try and facilitate that slightly more formal working together, you know, amalgamations, mergers and partnership working among charities. And that's also something that a lot of funders have tried to do. That's not always easy. And sometimes the more specific contractual things like shared services are a bit easier.
Okay, that's really helpful. Thank you. So I'd just like to say thanks to you, Marika, and Martin, for coming along today. And I will now briefly suspend the meeting for the set-up of our next agenda item. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Welcome back. Our next item today is consideration of a document subject to parliamentary control, the draft proposed revised Social Security Charter. The Social Security Charter sets out what the social security principles mean in practice and lists around 50 commitments to be delivered by the Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland. The proposed revision to this is included in Annex A of Paper 4. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this document at its meeting on the 28th of May 2024 and made no recommendations in relation to this. We will first have an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice on the document, and the committee will then be invited in the upcoming agenda item to consider a motion to approve it. So can I welcome to the meeting Shirley-Ann Subble, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, and I also welcome to the meeting David Wallace, Chief Executive of Social Security Scotland, and Kyle Murray, Procedural and International Policy Team Leader, Scottish Government. Thank you for joining us today, and can I remind everyone that Scottish Government officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. So I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, Convener. I welcome the opportunity to assist the committee in its consideration of the proposed revised Social Security Charter, which was laid in Parliament on the 16th of May. In 2019, following an in-depth co-design process with people who had lived experience of the UK benefits system, the Social Security Charter was published. The Charter sets the standards for the performance of Social Security Scotland, and the Charter Measurement Framework, which is published annually, assesses how Social Security Scotland and the Scottish Government are delivering on commitments and identifies areas for improvement. In effect, it took the Social Security principles in the 2018 Act from high-level ambitions to more detailed commitments, underpinning everything we do with dignity, fairness and respect. It is a requirement that the Charter is reviewed every 5 years, and this is the first review since it was made in 2019. A significant difference since then is that we now have a maturing social security system delivering 14 benefits to the people of Scotland, with 7 of those only available in Scotland. So where the original charter was co-designed by people who had experience of the UK benefits system, the revisions have been co-produced with people who have experience of engaging with the new Scottish system. I would therefore like to extend my sincere thanks to all the individuals and organisations who supported the review process. Convener, it's important that the committee appreciate that one of the key findings of this process was that the Charter as it exists is already held in high regard by all parties consulted. This is evidenced in the limited number of proposed changes. The changes and restructuring therefore largely reflect a social security system that is now operational, while adopting a more inclusive and consistent use of language. Fundamentally, the revised Charter continues to uphold the 8 Scottish Social Security principles set out in that 2018 Act, reinforcing the Scottish Government's strong-held view that social security is a human right. I recently visited Motherwell and Grangemouth, amongst other places, and there I met with a number of clients who shared positive experiences that they had had with the social security system. Some highlighted that they finally felt listened to and treated like human beings, as opposed to how it felt under the previous system. I'm in no way saying, Convener, that there is not improvements that we need to make, but we are determined to make those. I remain proud of what we have achieved so far to date. Similar views on the social security system were offered by clients during the charter review process. The committee should be reassured that the revised commitments are therefore truly reflective of the priorities identified by clients, social security colleagues and partner organisations, and improve upon an already highly regarded document. Subject to parliamentary approval, the Scottish Government and Social Security Scotland will work to meet the revised commitments and ensure that the delivery of social security reflects the wishes of those who invested their time and effort in this review. I'd like to thank the committee for its proposed scrutiny of the Charter.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I will now move on to questions, and our questions will be directed to you, but you are of course welcome to invite any officials to respond to should you wish to do so. So I'm going to start on the theme of the purpose of the Charter, and I'm going to invite Jeremy Balfour in. Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary, good morning, Mr. Wallace and to Mr. Murray. I wonder if we can just start with a very basic question. That is, do you see this as an aspirational document, or is it a reality today? Where does it sit in that kind of spectrum?
Well, I think when you look at the measurement charter, the measurement of the charter, you see that clients do largely feel that this reflects the service that they are having at the moment. However, as I've said in my opening remarks, and I say often in the chamber, this is still a very new system. It's a system which we are keen to continuously improve. So I'm very proud of the fact that we are seeing very good results through the measurement framework, but we are determined to go further on that. So, yes, it's something which is a living, breathing document as part of the agency at the moment, but we do know that we can always and will do better in the future.
That's helpful, thank you. Despite being in the original charter, was it ever Social Security Scotland's intention to make referrals to other organisations providing advice and information? And I wonder, is this an example of changing something which is aspirational or just being descriptive of current procedure?
So I think this is one of the aspects where we have got a bit sharper with our language in the review. Colleagues will be aware that the term referral is often taken to have a very specific meaning around welfare rights and so on, and between public bodies. In essence, that can therefore mean the sharing of personal data. And that's what that word will often suggest or infer to people. Now, clearly, there are complications around sharing personal data. It's not just something that the agency can do. We are, of course, working with the agency to improve that where it is helpful, but that's not something that can just be done on the whim of the agency. So I think a more sensible and appropriate language is now in there. David may wish to come in to give some details about what already happens within the agency to signpost on, for example, in award letters about other services that are available. And, of course, we have the independent advocacy service that's there as well. So I think this is one of the examples where we are trying, with the help of clients, to actually use the word in the charter that we are actually doing, while always, as I say, looking to the future to see how we can perhaps go further than that. But David may wish to elaborate on that if you'd like him to.
Yeah, I think just to emphasise that, it does feel like one of language. So referrals, you know, implied, I think, to the sector that we'd be wrapped up, we would be actively sharing the data. And that, as you know, comes into data sharing arrangements. It comes into actually technical ability to build platforms to enable that to, because, again, we wouldn't want that to be a manual process. So in that sense, I think we've got some work to do, but we absolutely do signpost. And both, as the Cabinet Secretary said, in letters, when people receive letters, they'll get some signposting, but also through the local delivery service that we're operating as well. And we've got some really good pilot examples as well. For example, in Dundee, where we're working around partners to make sure that we can hand off, if you'd like, sort of hot handoffs rather than necessarily just signposting people. So I think it's an area where there's definitely work that we would want to be doing more of, but we shouldn't underestimate, the effort and resource it will take us to take that the full line. And indeed, not all, as the Cabinet Secretary says, directly in our gift. We would need other organisations to work with us on that.
Grateful. I mean, perhaps been sitting too long beside Mr. Mason, but I mean, it was a very full review that you carried out. I wonder what costing did it cost to do this review, and is the cost being covered by Scottish Government or by the Social Security Scotland?
I might come in to answer that, although I should say I don't have the answer on the exact cost. I would imagine it was covered by my team's resources and the research team's resources as well, which was all done within the Scottish Government. So I don't think there's a specific budget line just for that. And I'm sorry, I forgot the second part of your question.
You've answered it in your what you've said. Great, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. Now moving on to the next theme, which is awareness of the Charter, and I'm going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
I'll maybe start with a supplementary to Mr Balfour, because, I mean, some of the changes are pretty small, aren't they? I mean, you know, we will becomes we apostrophe LL, and, you know, that's surely a question of taste or grammar. I mean, I prefer we will. I think that is clearer, but, you know, so you do feel this exercise has been worthwhile in the number of changes that have been made?
I think it's worthwhile. One, we're obligated to do it, so it's very worthwhile on that basis. But if the system had not been working effectively, as I say, not that there's not room for improvement, but if we didn't have an effective system that people did feel had dignity, fairness and respect at its heart, I think you would have seen an entirely different process here. You would have seen many more stakeholders wishing to be involved. You would have seen the feedback that was coming from clients being in a completely different ballpark to where it is. So the fact that some of it, as you say, Mr Mason, is very small changes, it's important that this was gone through with a very fine tooth comb by clients of the service and with our key stakeholders as well as staff. And that's a really important aspect for that to be tested by. We could have been in an entirely different place and this could have been a much more uncomfortable session. But I think the fact that the Charter is well regarded is demonstrated by the fact that the changes are, as you say, not just stylistic. There are some important changes in there, but they are relatively still very small.
Okay, and you say it's appreciated, but I just wonder how widely people are aware of it, because there's some suggestion that both amongst the users, the clients, and amongst the staff, people are not terribly familiar with it.
Well, I'll perhaps bring David in again to talk about some of the specifics, but I think what the important aspect to bear in mind is that the Charter is, if you like, the foundation or a cornerstone of what happens within not just Social Security, but how we approach Social Security within the Scottish Government as well. It's therefore embedded in everything that we do. So we don't start off every meeting quoting parts of the Charter, but it is in essence built into everything that we do, because that's why the type of staff training is delivered the way it is. It's the reason why the system's set up in the way that it is. It's, it infers through to the policy decisions that's made through in government. So in essence, it's embedded in everything. But David can point to also some of the specifics, because I think it is important that people also do know that there's a Charter there and can take cognizance of that as well.
So from an internal to the agency perspective, I saw some of those comments about people's, you know, staff's awareness of it. In some ways, I think, you know, there's also a kind of counter comments as to how aware people are of it. But for me, I think it's, as the Cabinet Secretary says, it's underpinning all the activity that we're doing. So there'll be stuff that we do which we don't necessarily, we are doing this because there's a Charter, but it will influence the culture and approach of the organisation. So if I look for an example, you know, we have done a lot of work around about intelligent kindness, which I think we've spoken to the committee about before, so people joining the organisation. The brilliant Tommy Whitelaw has been in and doing sessions around about what it means to be treated with kindness. Now, the Charter absolutely underpins that, but we don't start all of those sessions as a Cabinet Secretary by saying, you know, we're doing this because of the Charter. So we will raise awareness of it, and actually I think the refresh of this gives a really good opportunity for us to emphasise the Charter, because it is that point, you know, back in 2019, I guess linking to the aspirational, in a way it was aspirational, because we weren't doing all of those things that we knew we were about to do, whereas now we are. So we're able to sort of use that as a communication tool. So if you walk around our offices now, you'll see on our digital signage, you know, quotes from the Charter, you know, this is what the Charter means. So it's an opportunity, I think, the refresh to really hammer home. But I do worry if people are saying they don't understand or don't recognise it, but I think that doesn't necessarily mean to me they're not operating within the framework that it sets.
Thanks, Kavira.
Okay, thank you. And now focusing on the co-design process, I'm going to invite Katie Clarkin. Thank you.
Thank you. And Cabinet Secretary, you've already said something about this in your opening remarks, but perhaps you could give us a bit more information about the co-design process and how clients' priorities have been reflected in the revised charter. I understand there was a core client group of 16 participants, so perhaps you could expand on that and also how you attempted to capture other claimants' experiences.
Thank you. So this is a piece of work that is so important that we get to as many people as possible and a breadth of people, both directly to clients and also through stakeholders that represent clients, particularly those who are sometimes seldom heard in these types of activities. So there was obviously surveys that are given to clients. There was a series of workshops, and as you'd expect, the workshops allowed people to get into much more detail than you would be able to do just through a simple survey. There was engagement with people from seldom heard groups as a priority as well, because we need to specifically look at the barriers they might face when engaging with a public service. And I think that's given us a real wealth of evidence about how clients' priorities were reflected in the Charter already, but could be reflected slightly better in that as well. I don't know if you want to add anything to the specifics.
Sure, yes. So if you look at Section 18 of the Act, it prescribes certain groups that have to be consulted as part of this process. And so you can see in the evidence that we have consulted with all those groups, but we have gone further than that. I have the specific numbers here, mm-hmm. but just to say on clients specifically, we had over 850 mm-hmm. client panel members take part in the online survey. Okay. And then the number that you talk about with the core group, mm-hmm. that was the number of people that were wanting to and able to take part in the more in-depth workshops.
So can I ask how those 16 were selected?
Now, they were selected based on the benefits that they have received from Social Security Scotland. So it had a diverse mix rather than just mm-hmm. all disability benefits, for instance, and a mixture of demographic ranges as well. I'm not the researcher, and I'm afraid I'm not a good researcher here, so I can't mm-hmm. speak specifically as to the methodology for that, but I do know that it was deliberately mm-hmm. diverse. Mm-hmm. And we had a range of views expressed because I was part of the workshops as well and able to hear them.
Yeah, I understand. And I understand that only 7 stakeholder organisations responded to the survey. So how do you know that stakeholders' priorities are reflected in the revised charter?
Wasn't for the lack of trying that there was only 7 there. There is a stakeholder newsletter that goes out monthly.
Yeah. So, yes.
and that's distributed literally to thousands of organisations, as well as the fact that it was this review was directly promoted to welfare rights organisations. So there was absolutely the opportunity to be able to take part for a wide number of people. The partner organisations were invited to take part in the survey, one-to-one interviews and so on as well. As I said previously, I think this is a reflection of the fact that they didn't feel there was much to say on the charter, rather than the fact that they didn't know the review was going on. But to ensure that it was looked at in detail, there is also a research advisory group which includes Glasgow Disability Alliance, Carer Scotland, Child Poverty Action Group and others. And there was within that research advisory group another opportunity to steer the research and contribute to this as well.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much. Now, moving on to the actual application process, I'm going to invite Paul O'Kane in. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to Cabinet Secretary and officials. The Cabinet Secretary knows, because we've had many exchanges on it, that I've been particularly interested in terms of lengthy processing times. Mr Wallace will be aware of that as well. Indeed, I think generally we've heard some calls for there to be a target processing time set to allow clients an expectation in terms of when their claim is going to be processed. I think in terms of the reading of the wording of the Charter, there may be a view that we are perhaps watering down our commitment in that space, given that we are changing the language around handling applications as quickly as we can. Now, I appreciate what the Cabinet Secretary will probably say about lived experience, saying that that felt vague and perhaps could have more detail behind it. But I would be keen to get the Cabinet Secretary's sense of, you know, are we moving in the opposite direction in terms of clients having clearer timescales? And what does she feel the impact of removing that commitment to handle applications quickly as we can is going to have?
So this is one of the areas which I'm very pleased that the committee's given myself and David an opportunity to talk about, because this is very much driven by what came back from the clients, is that everybody here might have a different definition about what they put on as quickly. What we were quite rightly getting feedback from was there's no point having a word in there if it could be interpreted in lots of different ways to mean many things. So quickly might mean something different to me, to David, to yourself, to someone who's going through that process. And at that point, it becomes rather meaningless. So what the clients are asking for is to ensure that they are being updated on what is happening with their claim, and getting that information through so they actually have something that's much more specific to the type of benefit that they're on and the expectation about where that is in the system. That's much more useful, more meaningful to clients than a phrase about as quickly as we can. So the challenge that came back from that work was to ensure that actually what's in the charter means something to the clients that are going through the process. So this wasn't something that came from the government about a wish to water down on this issue by any means. It's something that came from the clients about this is actually a terminology within the original charter that actually could be interpreted in too many different ways. So I would suggest that where we've ended up with is actually a more stringent measure for the government and for the agency than what we had before. We have and we will continue to have discussions, I'm sure, on processing times. A committee has heard from me, has heard from David directly, on the fact that we know processing times were too long. They are coming down, we're very satisfied that that work is continuing, and there is still more that's still being put in place to make sure that we're on that journey. But that is very separate to the fact that there has been a change in the terminology within this document, and hopefully that demonstrates that the charter is very separate and has been through a process that is not impacted by what's happening on processing times within the agency.
I hear what the Cabinet Secretary said about, framework document in terms of more detail. And I think because the Charter is a foundational document, I think we wouldn't want to see a sense that, improving those times is not foundational, essentially, to Social Security Scotland. So I would just caution that I think there will be a reading of that that we have to be aware of. So it would be useful, I think, if a Cabinet Secretary could say within the Charter sort of measurement framework, what actual detail is going to go in terms of waiting times, call times, those sorts of issues?
Well, there's information that's in the Measuring Our Charter, and there's obviously the information that's published separately through official statistics. What I would say to Mr. O'Kane, that it could be read like that, you've heard from myself, David can obviously come in and speak on behalf of the agency. If there was a stakeholder organisation out there that felt that we were somehow gerrymandering this charter to make it easier for the agency, I can assure you, you would have heard from them by now. The fact that they are comfortable with the changes that are being made is a reflection that those who are either impacted directly on the system or work with those who are feel comfortable with the changes that are getting made. So I sincerely hope that no one makes any mischief by misinterpreting this, because we are satisfied that the stakeholders are satisfied with what we've done. So I hope there can be reassurance around that. So when we're talking about what's in the measuring of the Charter, to go back to your question, it's also important to say that it's not just about what's in the measuring of the Charter, but what's in the official statistics about processing times and so on as well. So I would say there's actually two ways to ensure that we are held to account for processing times, not just the Charter measurements directly.
I mean, I think that's why this scrutiny is important, because I think people will want to ensure that it's those processing times, certainly, that are improving. I don't know if Mr Wallace wants to add anything from the agency's point of view, convener.
Time
sure,
as well, so
yeah, happy just to hear from Mr Wallace.
Thank you.
I'd be in danger of agreeing with the Cabinet Secretary on lots of those points as well. I think, again, it's a point in time here. From my operational perspective, you know, taking out the word quickly does not... You know, isn't something we push for, and actually is a relatively easy but meaningless thing to sign up for. So I think losing that word, from my perspective, this, as CAB6 says, is a far more challenging set than was previously. I think there's something about trying to do that generically in a document like this as well. So our low-income benefits versus our disability benefits are very, very different. So the gauge around about what's acceptable or quick or speedy for a low-income benefit is entirely different to that of a disability benefit. So again, this is trying to be the underpinning framework rather than set those specifics around about it. And I know this wasn't particularly the question that was being asked, but we, you know, all of these measures we would see as important. It's why the Charter really is the thing that matters to us, because it's how people are treated. And way back to all the client research, it was how people were feeling, how people were treated, removing assessments. These were the parts that came across strongly. If the strength of feeling had been around about purely speed of application, we would have designed something differently, quite frankly. There will be a danger if that's the thing that we try to focus solely on as well. So I think the whole suite of measures is where I would say was really important for us operationally.
Okay, thank you very much. And moving on to our last theme, which is the local delivery service, I'm going to now invite Marie McNair in. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary and officials. Can I ask why the commitment to deliver face-to-face services has changed to a commitment to deliver in-person, if necessary? Is this just a reality of experience that shows that not everyone needs it? And will all clients be given the choice to have a local support provided in person?
So again, this is just something that's a tightening up of language. It's available to people should they wish it. The client's preference about how their needs are met is still absolutely integral, has been right from the start and will continue to be so. Face-to-face is very much part of the service. Anyone can have that. It's not just for someone who is housebound, for example. It's not just for someone that's on a disability benefit, but it's a recognition of the fact that particularly over the past couple of years, people are much more relaxed about using a video call, etc. Mm-hmm. So it's simply a change in language to reflect the fact that we've all changed the way in which we deal with public services. And for many people, not all, but for many people, that won't be face-to-face. But the face-to-face local delivery service is something that's unique to the social security system here in Scotland, and is something that's a very, very important, integral part of that we will absolutely not be losing.
Thanks for that.
Okay, thanks very much. And that actually concludes our question session now. So moving on to agenda... Oh, sorry.
I just wondered if there's time for one extra question.
Yeah. Yep.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, obviously when we were putting through the original Charter, there was lots of discussions about whether it should have a legal status and what status it should have, and the Parliament came to view that it should just remain as it is rather than any legal status. Obviously we are putting through a bill at the moment which is looking at the Act. As you've done this, has there been any thought given to whether its status is in the right place, whether it should have a higher status or anything around that?
I think the fact that it's not been raised with us is a suggestion that more importantly than what I think about it, others are more relaxed about where that is. So I would take, again, from the fact that feedback hasn't came from stakeholders that they wish to see a change as something that they are satisfied with. Obviously, if there's something out there that hasn't came through as part of the review process, then I'd be happy to hear from stakeholders on that. But I'm not aware that anyone's calling for that.
Thank you, Camilla. Helpful.
Okay. that now that concludes our question session. So moving on to agenda item 5 is the formal consideration of motion S6M13481. That the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the proposed revised Social Security Charter SJ/2024/96 be approved. I invite the Cabinet Secretary to speak and move the motion.
Moved, Convener.
Thank you. I now invite contributions from members. No? Okay. The question is that motion S6M13481 in the name of Shirley Ann Somville be approved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Following today's proceedings, a draft report will be prepared by the clerks. The committee is invited to decide whether to consider that draft report in private at a meeting in the coming weeks. Do members agree? Okay, thank you. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary and thank you to the officials as well. So this concludes our public business for today and we will now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. Thank you.